Single turbo, twin scroll turbo, variable geometry turbo. All of these things make cool noises, big power, make your car go fast, but to understand them better, we need to take a closer look at how each one works. At the end of the day, almost all turbochargers work exactly the same, but in the automotive world, we have six main different types of turbochargers that you'll find. Why six different types? Well, as time has gone on and as the industry has gotten more advanced and as emission laws keep crushing down and making it harder and harder to pass, as you need more and more efficient vehicles, turbochargers have gotten more advanced and more efficient. Basically, the need for ever efficient engines is never ending until everybody switches to electric. Now, the six different types of turbos that you'll find are the single turbo, twin scroll turbo, variable geometry turbo, variable twin scroll turbo, and electric turbos. Before we can take a deep dive into each type of turbo and how they work, what makes them special, we should first discuss where the turbocharger came from and who invented it. A turbocharger, better known as just a turbo, is a turbine system that pushes air into your engine. Now, it does this by using exhaust gases, which is a byproduct of combustion, to spin a turbine on one side of the turbocharger, which has a shaft connected to it, onto the cold side of the turbocharger, which is the intake side. This pushes air into your engine, this creates boost pressure, and with more air comes more fuel. And with more air, you can add more fuel, which means a larger combustion and more power. The turbocharger was invented by a Swiss engineer named Alfred Bucci. When the turbocharger was originally invented, all forms of forced induction were referred to as superchargers, and this new invention was named the turbo supercharger. Today, it's referred to as just turbocharger because the term supercharger refers to mechanically driven forced induction systems. An example of something very similar to a turbocharger that's mechanically driven is a centrifugal supercharger, which removes the hot side of the turbo in favor of a pulley. All right, now that you have a basic idea of what a turbo is, how it works, and where it came from, let's take a deep dive into each different type of turbo and what makes each one special. Single turbochargers are what most people think of when they hear the term turbocharger, and there's only a few different ways that you can change how a single turbocharger behaves, and that's mostly changing the size of either the housing or the internals on either the intake side or the exhaust side. If you want top-end power, you need a big turbo. If you want low-end power, you need a small turbo. But with a small turbocharger, you're going to run out of steam very quickly at high RPM, and it's going to superheat the air and really run out of efficiency. With a big single turbo, you're going to have very poor transient response. So when you first get on the throttle, it's going to take a second for that turbocharger to spool up and really provide any power. For many modern turbocharged cars that use a single turbo, you'll find that they use a pretty small turbocharger, and that's because when you're driving around on the street, you're going to be at low RPM most of the time. You're not going to want to have to ring your engine out to, you know, 6,000 or 7,000 RPM just to get efficiency out of the turbo. So for most cars, especially if you look at something like a Ford EcoBoost, they're gonna have very, very small turbochargers which produce peak torque and peak boost anywhere from 2,000 to 3,500 RPM. Single turbos are a cost-effective way of increasing engine power and efficiency, and as such have become increasingly popular, allowing smaller engines to increase efficiency by producing the same power as a larger naturally aspirated engine. Unfortunately, a basic single turbo only works best in a narrow RPM range, and if you want a wide power range while maintaining great throttle response, you'll need a more modern setup or even a twin turbo setup. As the name implies, a twin turbo setup is basically a single turbo setup, but with another turbocharger. You're literally just taking a single turbo setup and adding another turbo. In the case of something like a V engine, this is really easy because you can have one turbo per side of the engine. So if you had a V8, you have one side of the engine with four cylinders, one side of the engine with four cylinders. Each turbo would be powered by the four cylinders of each bank. Within the twin turbo name, there are a few different variations and a few different ways to set up a twin turbo system to get different effects. Parallel twin turbo setup uses two equally sized turbochargers which receive half of the exhaust gases exiting the engine. This type of setup is really popular with V engines since you can use the same setup on each side of the motor. The aim of a parallel twin turbocharger setup is to reduce lag by using two smaller turbochargers which can move an equal amount of air as one larger turbocharger. The next type of system that you'll see is a sequential twin turbo system which uses two different size turbochargers to better cover the entire RPM range. This type of system uses one turbocharger for lower RPM speeds and a second or both turbochargers for higher RPM speeds. This basically allows you to have peak power of a larger turbo without the poor transient response or lag from using one large turbo. A sequential system is arranged so that the small turbocharger is creating boost while the engine is operating at low RPM, which reduces the boost threshold and lag, and as RPMs increase, the big turbo begins to spool up and create boost. It's important to note that with a sequential setup, each turbo feeds the engine independently. They do not feed each other. That type of system is known as a serial or compound setup. With a compound setup, the first turbocharger provides the initial compression and the second turbo turbocharger takes the charge from the first turbo and compresses it even further. The downside to a system like this is it often leads to a large amount of turbo lag. This type of setup is not very popular with gasoline engines, but it's fairly common in the world of high-performance diesel engines, since diesels don't suffer from pre-ignition issues and can survive much higher amounts of boost pressure compared to gas engines. Simply put, a compound twin turbo system is going to give you the best performance and the most amount of boost pressure compared to any other type of twin turbo system. The turbo setups that most of us are familiar with are single scroll turbos. So when we look at twin scroll turbos, they look very similar, but they function quite different. A standard single scroll turbocharger uses all the exhaust gases and all the thermal energy from that to power the turbocharger, but it doesn't maximize the use of the pulse energy of the exhaust pulses that are coming out of the engine. This is where a twin scroll turbo takes things to a whole new level by harnessing that pulse energy on top of the thermal energy. A twin scroll turbo is nearly identical to a single scroll turbo, but the exhaust inlet is split into two. It's split into two so that half your cylinders can power one scroll. For example, in a four cylinder engine with a firing order of 1, 3, 4, 2, cylinders 1 and 4 might feed one scroll of the turbo while cylinders 2 and 3 feed a separate scroll. The downside to a twin scroll system are poor efficiency at high engine load and speed, and a complex and expensive exhaust manifold and turbine casing. To put that really, really simply, a twin scroll turbo is just like a single scroll turbocharger, but a twin scroll turbo also harnesses the pulse energy of those exhaust pulses coming out of the engine to further improve efficiency of the turbocharger. These types of turbos aren't super popular with aftermarket performance, and it's typically only something you'd see on an OEM application because it is a little bit complicated and they're not particularly efficient at really high loads or really high speeds where you'd be better off with a single scroll turbocharger. The next type of turbo that we'll look at is the variable geometry turbo, also known as a VGT. Typically, VGTs include a ring of vanes in the housing. These internal vanes alter the turbo's area to radius ratio, also known as the AR ratio, to match the engine RPM and give peak performance. At low RPM, a low AR ratio allows a turbo to spool up quickly by increasing exhaust gas velocity, and at higher RPMs, the AR ratio increases. This results in a low boost threshold, which ultimately reduces turbo lag and provides a wide and smooth torque band. VGTs typically are used on diesel engines. It's not something you very often see on gasoline engines. That's because diesel engines have much lower exhaust gas temperatures compared to gasoline engines, and VGTs need that lower exhaust gas in order to survive. So basically, with a gasoline engine, you're going to see a lot more VGT failure, and gasoline engines that have used VGT turbos have to use a lot of turbo cooling in order for the turbo to have any sort of reliability or life. As the name suggests, a VTS turbo basically just takes the best of both worlds with a twin scroll turbo and a variable geometry turbo and combines them into one unit. A variable twin scroll turbo has a valve that can redirect exhaust airflow into just a single scroll or vary the amount that the valve opens and allows for the gases to completely split between the two scrolls. The whole idea behind this is to have the best of both worlds, but that also means the cost of both worlds. The variable geometry twin scroll turbocharger is one of the newest designs that you'll find on the market, and it hasn't really been used extensively in any sort of production vehicle, and that's mostly due to cost and a couple of other things. The last type of turbocharger that we're going to look at is the electrically assisted turbocharger, also just known as an electric turbo. This is basically just a standard turbocharger, but the compressor side, or the intake side, or cold side, whatever you want to call it, has an electric motor to help assist it. The electric motor helps spool up the turbocharger at low RPM, and then as the turbo RPM increases, the main part of the turbo takes over, and then the electric part is no longer assisting. So it kind of works like a hybrid drivetrain in a vehicle, where at low RPM, you're going to have electric assistance to help get the vehicle up to speed, or in this case, you're just going to have the electric assistance to help get the turbocharger up to speed, so you have really good transient response and very minimal boost lag, and you're also going to have a much wider power range. And then as the boost pressure increases and as the engine RPM increases, the turbocharger will start to function like a normal turbo. Simply put, this means you could use a large turbo and the electric assist will make it act more like a small turbo. So you'll have really good low end power and really good transient response, but you'll also have the top end power of a big single turbo or a big twin turbo. The electric turbo system also has another benefit, and that's when you let off the gas, your turbocharger is still spinning. It doesn't immediately just, you know, fall in RPM. So when you let off the gas, there's a lot of inertia and a lot of energy still there. And you can harness that energy.
Harnessing the good energy? Walk out the back.
With an electric motor, and basically use your turbocharger as a generator to help power the batteries. And this means that when you get back on the gas, you already have some energy saved up from the last time you let off the gas to help power that electric turbo. So that's about it for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, please smash the thumbs up button. If you think there's anything I missed or anything you want to add, please drop it down in the comments, and I'll see you guys in the next one.